introduction. I can't wait to hear the speaker myself. First of all, I have a confession to make. It's true that New York Magazine recently voted me as one of the 100 smartest people in New York. However, in all fairness, I have to admit that Madonna also made that same list. And next year, they tell me that Lady Gaga is going to push me off the list entirely. Today, I want to talk about the future of the mind. It's very dangerous talking about the future and making predictions. Let me quote from that great philosopher of the Western world, Yogi Berra. Yogi Berra once said, quote, "Prediction is awfully hard to do, especially if it's about the future." Well, I'm a physicist. We're the ones who invented the laser. We invented the transistor. We helped to assemble the internet. We wrote the World Wide Web. Along the way, we also invented television. We invented radio, radar, microwaves, MRI scans. And don't forget, we also helped to create the space program and the GPS satellite. And we physicists love to make predictions. When we helped to assemble the internet, one physicist predicted that the internet would become a forum of high culture, high art, and high society. Well, today we know that 5% of the internet is pornography. But that's because teenage boys log on to the internet. Just wait until the grandmas and grandpas log on to the internet. Then 50% of the internet will be pornography. But you may ask yourself a question, what is the difference? The difference between physics, chemistry? Well, let me tell you a little story. During World War II, the Nazis once captured a bunch of American scientists and called them spies and put them on the firing squad to shoot them. There was a geologist, a physicist, and a chemist about to be shot by firing squad. Well, they put the geologist up there. They pointed the rifles, and suddenly the geologist said, "Earthquake! Earthquake! Earthquake!" Everyone scrambled, ran for cover, and the geologist escaped because there was no earthquake. Then it was time to put the physicists on the firing squad. They put their rifles up, and the physicist said, "Lightning, lightning, lightning," and everyone scrambled, and the physicist escaped. Now it was the chemist's turn. The firing squad pointed their rifles at the chemist, and the chemist said, "Fire, fire." Well, I had the chance to interview over 300 of the world's top scientists, many of them neurologists, Nobel Prize winners, about the future of science. And they tell me that the brain is the most complex object in the known universe. It weighs 3 pounds, it sits on your shoulders, but it is more complicated than a supercomputer. And in fact, a city block of supercomputers would be necessary to simulate what sits on your shoulders. It would consume the energy of a nuclear power plant. It would take a river to cool down this city block of supercomputers. And your brain, sitting on your shoulders, the most complex object in the known universe, only uses 20 watts of power. So when someone calls you a dim bulb, that's a compliment. And my previous book was called Physics of the Future, a New York Times bestseller about the next 10, 20, 50 years. This proved a theorem. Many people have said that the word physics will never enter the New York Times bestseller list. I disproved them twice. Physics of the impossible takes you 500 years into the future, where we might have starships, maybe even time travel and teleportation. And in this book, I answer the question, what happens if you go into a time machine and go backwards in time to meet your teenage mother before you're born and she falls in love with you? Well, if your teenage mother falls in love with you before you're born, you're in deep doo-doo if that happens. But today, let us talk about the most complex object in the known universe. First of all, the Big Bang and the brain are the two greatest mysteries in all of science. Professionally, what I do for a living is work on something called string theory, which hopes to decipher and understand the instant of genesis. We hope to have an equation, which is perhaps no more than 1 inch long, that will allow us to, quote, read the mind of God. That's my day job. That's what I do for a living. But as a child, I've often been fascinated by the mind. In fact, when I was a kid, I used to do telepathy experiments. I used to try to read the minds of other people. I tried to do telekinesis, moving objects with my mind. Finally, I came to the conclusion that maybe telepaths do walk the surface of the earth, but I wasn't one of them. Later, I decided to become a physicist. So when I was in high school, at Cumberley High School, a few miles from here, I went up to my mom one day, and I said, Mom, can I have permission to build an atom smasher in the garage? A 2.3 million electron volt betatron particle accelerator. And my mom stared at me and said, sure, why not? Don't forget to take out the garbage. So I went to Westinghouse, not too far from here. I got 400 pounds of transformer steel, and I wound 17 miles of copper wire on the Cumberley High School football field. I put 17 miles of copper wire in the goalpost, gave it to my mother. She took the wire and ran to the 50-yard line and gave it to my father. He would take it from the 50-yard line and take it to the other goalpost, and over Christmas, we wound 17 miles of copper wire. Finally, it was ready. It consumed 6 kilowatts of power, everything my garage was supplying. I closed my eyes, plugged my ears. I plugged in my atom smasher, and I heard this huge crackling sound as 6 kilowatts of energy surged through my magnets. And then I heard a pop, pop, pop sound as I blew out every circuit breaker in the house. The whole house was plunged in darkness. And my poor mom, she'd come home from a hard day's work, see the lights flutter, and she would say, where's the fuse box? And she must have said to herself, why couldn't I have a son who plays basketball? Maybe if I buy him a baseball. And for God's sake, why can't he find a nice Japanese girlfriend? I mean, what's wrong with him? Anyway, we now believe that the genome has unlocked the secrets of medicine and genetics. And then President Barack Obama, last January, stunned the scientific community by announcing the Brain Initiative, the next big science project of the century will be to create a map of all the neurons in our body. This is the next big crash program in science. The short-term benefit is to cure mental illness. Mental illness is one of the great illnesses of the human race. The Bible mentions mental illness. So why not create a disc with all our neurons, our memories, our hopes and dreams on a disc. And some people say, maybe after we die, that disc will live on forever as a form of immortality. So when I was a kid, I loved the idea of reading other people's minds, sending my thoughts through space. I read science fiction stories about telepaths with enormous physical and mental powers. So I love to watch the Hollywood movies. And now we have movies like The Matrix, where memories can be uploaded into the mind. This is Hollywood, but we scientists now can do it. uploading memories into the mind. Maybe reality itself, as in the Matrix, is a fiction. Maybe everything you see around you is an illusion. In fact, late at night, when you're all by yourself, have you ever thought that maybe, just maybe, you are the only one in the universe and everyone else is an illusion? Ever had that feeling late at night just before you go to sleep that, hey, maybe I'm the only one and nature or God or whatever is trying to test me to see whether I'm smart enough to figure I'm the only one? Raise your hand. Raise your hand if you ever had that feeling late at night. Few of you. Well, you're crazy. What? You think you're the only one in the universe? Give me a break. You see, I'm the only one in the universe. You are a fiction. I'm really in bed all by myself, thinking that I'm giving this lecture to 900 people. Come on, give me a break. I'm all by myself. And here's the former governor of California. In one of his better moments, having memories of being married to Sharon Stone inserted into his mind. Is that possible? It's something we're going to talk about today. Because last year, the first memory was recorded and inserted into the brain of a mouse. And then very soon, perhaps starting next year, trials will begin on monkeys and eventually Alzheimer's patients. We want to be able to upload memories into Alzheimer's patients by creating a brain pacemaker. And that's coming soon. And then there's Iron Man comics. Young kids dream about mentally controlling mechanical arms and legs. And believe it or not, we can do it. We can now create Iron Man. Energized, controlled by the power of pure thought. And what about robots that have perfect bodies but are controlled mentally by humans? This could be the future of the space program, where we send superhuman robots to the moon, governed mentally by astronauts sitting in the luxury of their living rooms. These are called surrogates or avatars. Avatars represent one of the cutting edges of this research. And then Hollywood, of course, talks about telekinesis. This is Carrie, who was made fun of throughout her years in high school. So on her senior prom, she decides to take revenge by destroying the entire high school. What's the lesson here? The lesson here is never take a telekinetic to the senior prom. And even in the latest Superman movie, every kid knows that Superman's father died on Krypton. But here on the right is Russell Crowe, Superman's father, who comes back as a hologram. The memories, the emotions, the essence of Superman's father is now a computer program, and he comes back as a hologram. Is this possible? 5 years ago, I would have said no. Now we realize it is a possibility. And then in Star Trek, we have the possibility that maybe consciousness can exist independent of the body. And perhaps, as Isaac Asimov once said, pure consciousness could roam the universe at the speed of light. That was once considered nonsense, but not anymore. So let's now talk about real science. We just talked about Hollywood. Let's talk about real science. We can now use MRI scans to analyze blood flow of the human brain to tell where certain parts of the brain light up. On the left is your brain when it tells the truth. Not much happens. But on the right is your brain when it tells a lie. You see, first you have to know the truth. Then you have to create the lie. Then you have to calculate the consistency of the lie with all the previous lies you've been telling all these years. That's a lot of brain power. Your brain lights up like a Christmas tree. And the brain is also a museum of all the previous stages of evolution. Three parts to the brain. In the back, The very back of the brain is the so-called reptilian brain. It governs balance. It governs hunger. It governs territoriality. In a car accident, if you injure the back part of your brain, you begin to lose your balance. Then the center part of the brain is the monkey brain, the brain of emotions. And right underneath your forehead is your thinking brain, your prefrontal cortex. Now, we can actually prove or disprove many old wives' tales by using brain scans to see inside the living brain. One old wives' tale, told by many parents, is that teenagers suffer from brain damage. Every parent believes so. We can now prove it's true. It turns out the prefrontal cortex, right behind your forehead of teenagers, is not fully formed. Your suspicions are correct. Your teenage kids do suffer from brain damage. Another old wives' tale is that when a man looks at a pretty girl, he starts to act stupid. Well, brain scans show that if a man looks at a pretty girl, blood drains from his prefrontal cortex. You can actually see that. He does become retarded. Absolutely true. Many old wives' tales we can actually see looking at blood flow of the living brain. And if you were to open up the skull horizontally and touch the skull, touch the brain, you feel nothing because the brain has no pain sensors. You can literally touch the brain with electrodes and all of a sudden your hand starts to move or your feet starts to move. So then you can calculate what part of the brain controls what part of the body. And this is what you find. So this means that animals would have a different picture than us. We devote a lot of our brain to eyesight, to our mouth and our fingertips. A dog, however, would devote most of its brain to his nose, because dog consciousness is smells. They live in a world of smells. If you're a bat or you're a dolphin, you would have sound or sonar. Now, let's say you're a cat lover. How many people out there are cat lovers? Just out of curiosity, oh wow. Let's say you have a cat and you think that maybe cat consciousness is the same as human consciousness. No. When a cat comes up to you and purrs and rubs next to your feet, you say, oh, nice putty cat, so affectionate. But if you could read the mind of the cat is saying, this human is mine. I'm going to rub my hormones on this human because he's part of my territory. I trained this human. This human feeds me twice a day. Good human. So cat consciousness is quite different from our consciousness. And why are cats solitary? They're solitary because they're descended from the wild cat. The wild cat hunts by itself. Now, look at the dog. The dog comes up to you and slobbers all over you, unlike the cat. How many people here are dog owners? Wow, the other half. Well, it turns out, if you scan the brain of a dog, it's mainly a world of smells. And why do they slobber all over you? Because in the dog's world, you are a dog. Except you are top dog. You are the leader of the pack. Because dogs are pack animals. They hunt in packs, they follow the top dog. So next time a dog comes up to you and slobbers all over you, he thinks that you're a dog. And notice in this diagram, you have two hemispheres, the left hemisphere and the right hemisphere. In epileptics, the two sometimes go out of control. So we have to cut the link between the left and the right hemispheres. And scientists were shocked at what they found. They found that over time, two distinct personalities began to emerge in the same brain, with the left hemisphere and the right hemisphere diverging. In fact, in one patient, one hemisphere was an atheist. The other hemisphere was a believer. And both of them fight for control over the hands, just like in Dr. Strangelove. Now, can you imagine somebody such that one half of the brain is Republican and the the other half of the brain is Democrat. And when they go to the polling booth and they have one chance to pull down that lever, they fight. They fight to see who's going to grab that lever. These are some of the strange things that occur in the world of neurology. Now, to access the mind, we used to put electrodes on their brain to pick up radio signals and electrical signals from their brain. Well, maybe you don't want to look like a refugee from Star Trek. Now, we can make it sexy. Now you put on a headband, and you can play video games on the upper left, video games by thinking. And in Japan on the upper right, this is the rage of the teenage scene. You put a headband on your head with two ears on it. It picks up brain waves. And when you meet someone at a party, and you're excited and interested, the two ears light up. But if you're bored stiff and are stuck with a jerk, then the two ears start to go down. So at parties, you know exactly who you are impressing and who you are boring. And so you know ahead of time whether or not you're going to go home all alone. And just think, one day, I'm a professor, one day I'm going to make all my students wear this. And so I'll know whether my students are falling asleep or whether they're listening to my lecture on the basis of their ears. And on the lower left, Apple, Microsoft, they're looking at the possibility of computers run by the mind. No mouse, just the mind. So in the future, when you walk into a room, perhaps you'll send radio signals to the lights, the PC, the thermostat, everything, in fact your car, everything will be driven by the human mind. And it'll be sexy. Madison Avenue is already thinking about how can they market this? Fashion models. All of a sudden it becomes fashionable to control the world mentally. Even drive your car mentally. And the implications of this medically are enormous. This is my colleague, Stephen Hawking. When I visited his house, I used to see all the gadgets he had in order to turn pages and take books off a shelf. He can't do that anymore. In fact, he's lost total control of his fingers. But hey, we're physicists. So what did we do? We put a chip in his right glass. The next time you see him on TV, look at his right frame. There is a chip with an antenna. It picks up radio from his brain, converts it to digital, and he operates a laptop computer. This is how Stephen Hawking communicates with the world. And we now can hook the brain directly to an exoskeleton. This work is being done at Duke University, Johns Hopkins University. We take a chip about the size of a dime and put it directly on the skull. It's painless because the brain has no pain sensors. But we hook that to a laptop computer. This gentleman here is a vegetable. He cannot talk. He cannot do anything except blink. Blink is the only thing he can do. We hooked up his brain to a computer at Brown University. He can now read email, write email, surf the web, play video games, do crossword puzzles, operate his wheelchair, operate household appliances, and he is totally paralyzed. Next, we hooked up a paralyzed person to a mechanical arm. This person can only blink and communicate with the outside world. When scientists at Brown hooked her up to a mechanical arm, she started to blink. And when people translated her blinking, she said, "I hope they hook up my legs next, because that's coming." The military has thousands of people from Iraq and Afghanistan helpless because they've lost limbs. Mechanical arms and legs are being created. In fact, at the next international soccer game in Brazil, scientists at Duke University, North Carolina, want to create a complete exoskeleton. We think that at the next World Cup soccer games in Brazil, somebody who is totally paralyzed will initiate the games with an exoskeleton guided mentally mentally by the power of the human mind. And then in Japan, they've hooked up Asimo, one of the world's most advanced robots, to a human. So the human controls the avatar. Now, pure artificial intelligence turned out to be more difficult than we scientists thought. Asimo here is one of the world's most advanced robots built in Japan. It can run, it can walk, it can climb upstairs, it can dance. In fact, it dances much better than me. I've been on many science specials with Asimo. Each time he dances better than me. What can I say? However, I interviewed for BBC television the creator of Asimo, and I asked him, how smart is the world's smartest robot? Are the robots going to get smarter than us very soon? Are they going to put us in zoos and put us behind bars and throw peanuts and make us dance behind bars? Is that our future? And then the inventor of this robot told me, Asimo, the world's most advanced robot, has the intelligence of a cockroach, a stupid cockroach, a retarded, stupid, lobotomized cockroach. So why not hook him up to a human? And that's what they've done here. This gentleman has a hat hooked up with electrodes that pick up radio and electrical emissions and then guide the robot. This is Avatar. Remember the movie Avatar? You sit in a pod and you control a robot, another being, just like this. This could be the future of the space program. It could be the future of education. Because we all know that school children love to play hooky. Come on, Fessa, you probably played hooky when you were young, right? Well, we can now, from your bed, because you're sick, energize a surrogate that goes to school and listens to the teacher. And the teacher can see your image in the surrogate. Isn't the future wonderful? You'll never be able to play hooky in the future again. And we can now connect the brain in another way, via your eye. Your eye is an extension of the brain. And we can now create contact lenses that have the internet. So who will be the first people to buy internet contact lenses? College students taking final examinations. They will blink and see all the answers to the exam in their contact lens. And who's the next person to buy these internet contact lenses? President Barack Obama, so he doesn't have to have these teleprompters with him all the time. And who's the third person to buy internet contact lenses? President Joe Biden, so he never says anything goofy and off message. And who's the next person to buy internet contact lenses? Tongue-tied Romeos, who cannot speak to their loved ones very well. In the future, Romeos will have the words of poetry, poetry coming out of their mouths to their loved ones, because they'll be reading a script in their contact lens. So, surrogates may one day go to outer space. Astronauts will sit in the comfort of their living room and guide a robot on the moon. Or fireman jobs, construction worker jobs that are dangerous. For the most dangerous jobs, we can send in robots guided by pure thought. So, revolutionary prosthetics. This is being pushed by hospitals, the university, and now even the government and the Pentagon. But the next big breakthrough will be in memory. Wouldn't it be nice to one day push a button and learn calculus and all the courses we flunked in college? Well, on the upper left is the hippocampus, the gateway to memory. That's where memories are formed. At Wake Forest University in North Carolina, they took a mouse, trained the mouse to sip water from a bottle, recorded the memory of doing so. Later, when the mouse forgot, they reinserted the memory back into the mouse and the mouse remembered it. This is the first time in history, just last year, that we recorded a memory and played it back, uploaded a memory. Next will be primates, and beyond that, Alzheimer's patients. They will be able to upload the memory of where they live, who their children are, and who they are. A brain pacemaker. This is going to revolutionize the way we view memory. And even beyond that, who knows? Maybe we'll be able to upload the memory of a vacation that we never had. Courses we never took. Skills that we never learned until recently. So we now know that the hippocampus, shown in red, is the gateway to memory. And when there's an injury to the hippocampus, you lose the ability to form long-term memories. It's a very sad case, but there was a gentleman called H.M. Many decades ago, his hippocampus was destroyed during an operation. Doctors made a mistake. Afterwards, he would greet you and say, hello, hi, how are you? And then he would forget who you were and start all over again and say, hello, hello, how are you? And he would do that for decades, decades. For the rest of his life, he relived those same moments over and over again. His case was so unusual, they made a movie about it, starring Drew Barrymore, 50 First Dates. A Hollywood movie, another Hollywood movie, Groundhog Day with Bill Murray. Both of them based on the true story of Mr. H.M., who would relive the same day over and over again. One day, decades later, he looked into a mirror and he saw himself as an old man. He was horrified. He knew he was a young man, but when he looked in the mirror, he saw the face of an old man and was horrified. But then he forgot that too, and then began to say, hello, hello, how are you, all over again. This is what we can cure if we have an artificial hippocampus. Now, at Berkeley, what are they doing? At Berkeley, they're doing research photographing a thought, maybe photographing a dream. Wouldn't it be great to wake up one day, push the play button, and see a video of the dream you had last night? Here's how they do it. The brain is put in an MRI machine and converted to 30,000 dots. It's a very awkward procedure, but we're making MRI machines smaller and smaller all the time. At the right-hand side is the world's smallest MRI machine. It's the size of a briefcase. So what they do is, they MRI the brain and collect 30,000 dots. A computer analyzes these 30,000 dots and then creates a picture. Here are the pictures. On the upper left is Steve Martin. Next to Steve Martin is a picture of Steve Martin as seen through your brain, as reconstructed by a computer. These pictures are amazing because they're fuzzy, but the very fact that we can do this is amazing. A picture of an elephant on the upper left becomes fuzzy on the upper right, but again, it looks like an elephant. An airplane also looks fuzzy, but the very fact that you can do this is astounding. And now dreams can also be photographed. The subject is put into an MRI machine, put to sleep, and the MRI machine generates pictures which can be analyzed by computers to create these photographs. And another old wives' tale is lucid dreaming. Lucid dreaming is when you are awake when you dream. You're conscious when you dream. You can actually change the course of a dream. Now, how many people in this room, raise your hand, how many people in this room have ever done lucid dreaming where you know you are awake and yet you are dreaming? Raise your hand. Oh, wow, look at all these people. Well, it turns out that in Germany, scientists put a lucid dreamer in an MRI machine and proved once and for all it is true. You can actually now prove using MRI scans that you can control the direction of your dream. There are Buddhist texts that are centuries old They'd even give you exercises. Exercise, just before you go to bed at night. Exercises that allow you to train yourself to become a lucid dreamer. So Leonardo DiCaprio, in the movie Inception, perhaps one day you may even be able to enter a dream. And now, mental illness. Mental illness is perhaps one of the oldest of all afflictions, and yet so many well-known individuals. In fact, for bipolar disorder, movie stars that you know and love, composers that you listen to, many of them have had bipolar disorder. On the upper left, for example, is the woman who played Lois Lane in the Superman movies. She had bipolar disorder. One day a few years ago, she was found stark naked, hiding behind garbage cans, fearful of being found out. She had an attack of bipolar disorder. We can now put these people in brain scans. We can't cure them yet, but we understand how it happens. Schizophrenia is when you hear voices. If you want to see what schizophrenia looks like, just go outside the door. Many of the homeless people, many people in jail, talk to themselves. And when you scan their brain, when you talk to yourself, what happens? First of all, the left part of your brain talks to yourself. That's why you can talk to yourself. The left part of your brain lights up. For these people, the left part of their brain lights up without their permission. Now, if you heard a voice in your mind without your permission, you would be considered mad. And we now know how schizophrenia works. The voices of the brain, generated by the brain, are disconnected from the prefrontal cortex. And maybe historical figures of the past suffered from mental illness. It turns out that if you have an epileptic lesion, sometimes in the left temporal lobe, you become hyper-religious. Everything that happens has a meaning. There are spirits, ghosts, gods everywhere. We think that Joan of Arc may have suffered from epileptic lesions, which causes hyper-religiosity. Now, it turns out we can induce hyper-religiosity manually with a helmet. It's called a God helmet. You put on the God helmet and it beams radio right to the left temporal lobe, inducing something that looks like epileptic lesions, and you begin to feel in the presence of God. This is the God helmet. So what did they do? Scientists took an atheist and put him in the God helmet. Richard Dawkins, the Oxford evolutionary biologist, is an outspoken atheist. They got him to put on the God helmet. Okay? Afterwards, he said, no, I'm still an atheist. And then they put nuns in the God helmet, and they interviewed them. And the nuns were not shaken. They simply said, God meant it to be that way. He created a telephone in our brain that allows us to communicate with heaven. That's how the nun sums it up. But as you can see, we have strange things going on in the mind, including super genius. It turns out that some gentlemen like this can take a helicopter ride over New York City Harbor, one helicopter ride, and draw the entire harbor, all of Manhattan, from memory. He's done it for Hong Kong. He's done it for London. And if you go to JFK Airport, the next time you are in JFK Airport Terminal 1, look up and you will see this incredible mural drawn by somebody who is a super savant. Now it turns out that we've analyzed people who have injuries to the left side of their brain and they become super geniuses. One person had a bullet that went through his left side as a youth. Another person hit his head on a swimming pool as he dove into the pool. Both of them wound up as mathematical geniuses. Now, tonight, do not pick up a hammer. Hit yourself on the left part of your brain. This is a very rare occurrence, but it is now well documented. So how does it work? Isaac Newton, we think, the greatest scientist who ever lived, probably had Asperger's syndrome. People with Asperger's syndrome have no social skills. You do not want to invite one to your senior prom or your dinner that night. They cannot carry on a conversation. And if you want to see what an Asperger's person looks like, it's television. So how is it that they can have photographic memory? If you take one of these people and ask them, what were you doing 30 years ago on May 2nd at 2 o'clock in the afternoon? They will say, I was on page 320 of a book, and they will recite the passage for you. How do they do that? Well, we have a theory now, scanning their brain. We now realize that the brain records memories, of course, but it also erases them. We used to think that memories naturally decay with time. That's the theory that is mentioned in most textbooks. We now realize that theory may be wrong. Forgetting is a complicated biochemical process. These people have forgotten how to forget. They simply remember everything that comes at them. This means that we have the ability, we too have the ability to have a photographic memory, except our memories are erased. If you disengage that mechanism, you will have photographic memory. And Einstein. Einstein's brain is still with us. Believe it or not, when Einstein died, his pathologist kidnapped the brain, stored it in his living room for 30 years in a cooler, drove cross-country putting Einstein's brain in a mayonnaise jar, and it finally has rested back at Princeton University. And scientists, of course, are eagerly analyzing Einstein's brain after being missing for 50 years. And we can now even test Freudian psychology. Freudian psychology is based on the idea that there is an id, superego, and libido, desire, guilty conscience, and self. But we can never test it. Now we can. With brain scans, you can see that the prefrontal cortex beneath your forehead is you, your ego. If you want to know late at night, where are you anyway? You are sitting right behind your forehead. Then the pleasure center is dead center in the nucleus accumbens, that's your pleasure center. And your guilty conscience is behind your eyes. And we can now take a mouse, hook up electrodes to the pleasure center, hook the electrodes to a telegraph key to stimulate the pleasure center. These mice will hit the telegraph key twice a second until they die of starvation. Next, they did it with dogs and even a dolphin with a big brain. The dolphin was hooked up with his pleasure center. By going forwards, he could excite the electrodes in his pleasure center. So the dolphin would also excite himself until he realized, I am dying. I am starving to death. So the dolphin would stop, go out and eat, and then come back and stimulate himself. That dolphin wasn't stupid. And then, what is consciousness? Well, you realize that theologians and psychiatrists, poets, they've written over 20,000 papers on consciousness with no agreement. Never in the history of science have so many written so much to produce so little. However, I have a theory of consciousness. You see, I'm a physicist. When we physicists look at an atom or a planet, how do we think? What is our consciousness? First, we create a model of the planet in space. Where is the planet located in space? Then we calculate the relationship of the planet to other planets. How does it interact with the sun and other planets? And then lastly, we run the videotape forward in time. We predict the future motion of a bullet, the future motion of a cannonball or rocket. That's how we physicists think. We create a model in space, a model with respect to other objects, and then we run it forward in time. So let's now take an attempt to define something that has resisted definition for 500 years. I define consciousness as the set of feedback loops necessary to create a model of yourself in space with regards to others, and then predicting the future. That's how we are separate from animals. Animals understand space. Animals understand social hierarchies, but animals do not understand tomorrow. They have no conception of planning for tomorrow. So I say that a thermostat has one unit of consciousness, one unit, because it measures temperature. A flower has 10 units, maybe. It measures water, temperature, sunlight, gravity. A reptile is part of the reptilian brain. It measures maybe 100 necessary to locate itself in space and locate other animals in space. Social animals have emotions. They're level 2 conscious because they have to understand their relationship to other animals. They are social animals. They hunt in packs. And what about us? We differ because we see the future. We plan for the future. Animals, when they hibernate, simply by instinct, store food and hibernate. Us, for humans, when it gets cold, we pack our bags, we have to winterize our house, we have to set the thermostat. We plan. We predict the future. And that's what I call human consciousness. And then, since I am running out of time, I'll try to summarize basically that the intelligence of robots, their consciousness is probably at level 1. They can barely locate their position in space, not in time. They certainly cannot see emotions. They cannot see their relationship to other people. But why does Japan create robots? 30% of all robots are built in Japan. 30%. Why? These are not thinking robots. They are robot nurses, because Japan is aging faster than any other industrialized nation. Europe is next. That's why Japan is building robot nurses. And, as I said, emotional robots represent level 2. At MIT, they're making the first attempt to build robots that can smile, cry, sympathize with you. And then, we have President Barack Obama's Brain Project. As I mentioned, the European Union and the United States will dump $1 billion starting this year to create a disk with all your neurons on it. This is called Brain 2.0. Brain 2.0 will be a backup copy of your brain. If we attain it, we'll begin to understand mental illness. We'll begin to understand why people have bipolar disorder, OCD, schizophrenia, Parkinson's, and perhaps cure them. And even beyond that, perhaps one day, because computer power accelerates with time, we will create a brain net where emotions, memories are sent on the internet. Can you imagine teenagers on Facebook? Teenagers on Facebook of the future, your kids may send memories, emotions on the Facebook, memories of a first date, memories of a first kiss sent on Facebook. That could be the future of the movies. One day the movies may also have emotions and memories in the movies. And it was Isaac Asimov who wrote a science fiction story, an outrageous science fiction story, that said that one day we'll send consciousness into outer space. Well, if we have that disk called the connectome with all your memories and all your personalities on it, maybe you become immortal. And maybe one day we could put it on a laser beam and send it into outer space at the speed of light. This is science fiction. But it means that one day we may explore the universe on light beams traveling at the speed of light. And now we'd like to end on a following note, and then I'll be glad to take questions from the audience and sign your copy of The Future of the Mind. And once I sign a copy of your book, you could go on eBay and sell it for money. My signature apparently is worth something. You got to make money tonight. Anyway, let me end on one last note. When I was a child, I had a role model. I used to idolize Albert Einstein. My favorite Einstein story is this. When Einstein was an old man, he was tired of giving the same talk over and over again. So one day, his chauffeur came up to him and he said, "Professor, I'm really a part-time actor. I've heard your speech so many times, I've memorized it. So why don't we switch places? I will put on a mustache. I will put on a wig. I will be the great Einstein, and you can take a rest and be my chauffeur." Well, Einstein loved the joke, so they switched places. This went along famously until one day, a mathematician in the back asked a very difficult question. And Einstein thought, "Oh, the game is up." But then the chauffeur said, "That question is so elementary that even my chauffeur here can answer it for you." Thank you very much. You're a great audience. Thank you. And we'll take questions. Questions from the audience. Thank you.
Thank you. That was excellent. I love all the work you do, and thank you for all that. So my question, the other day, my son came home, and he was very excited because he had heard that the universe just may be a hologram. And he was asking me, how could that be? And I had no idea how to explain that to him. And I was wondering if you might be able to just give me a few words of how to explain that. Thank you.
Okay, the idea of a hologram comes from string theory. A hologram is a two-dimensional plate, But when you shine a laser beam on it, a three-dimensional image emerges. So three dimensions is encoded on a two-dimensional plate. You lose one dimension. So when you go to Disney World, for example, and see these ghosts in the haunted house, how do they create these images of ghosts flying around in three dimensions? You're actually staring at a plate, a two-dimensional plate. When laser beams are shined in the plate, it creates the wavefront of a three-dimensional object. So what we say is, a hologram encodes three dimensions onto two dimensions, okay? Now in string theory, we have this rather bizarre concept that the universe is actually 10-dimensional. Not just one, not just two, but 10-dimensional. But we think it's encoded on our three-dimensional universe. So in which case, everything you see around you looks like it's three-dimensional, but actually is the encoding of a 10-dimensional universe. Now, if you want to know what 10 dimension is like, I used to go to the Japanese tea garden, located not too far from here, as a child. And I would spend hours looking at the fish, hours, swimming just beneath the lily pads. And I used to wonder, what is it like to be a fish? To swim in two dimensions, to go forward, backward, left, right, but any scientist who talked about up into the world of hyperspace, beyond the pond, he would be considered a crackpot. Nuts! What? The third dimension? No such thing. The pond is everything. So one day, I thought that maybe there was a scientist in the pond, a fish scientist, who would say, "Humbug." So I dreamt that I would grab the scientist, lift the scientist off the two-dimensional world into a holographic universe of three dimensions. What would he see? Beings moving without fins, a new law of biology. Beings moving, breathing, without water. Then I said to myself, one day, scientists will say, "We are the fish. We spend our lives in three dimensions, thinking that we can go forward, backward, left, right, and anyone who talks about up into hyperspace is considered nuts." Well, today, we no longer think you're nuts. We think there could be 10 dimensions, and we think some of these dimensions could be flattened out to give you the illusion that we are three-dimensional. So that is the holographic universe, and it comes out of string theory, which is what I do for my day job. Okay, next question.
Question number three. Why are certain subjects hard for different people?
Oh, why or what? I can't hear.
Certain subjects, like in school or work. Why are they hard for certain people? Why do people have different challenges with different subjects?
Oh, why are certain things harder to learn than other people? Well, personally, I think it's a question of presentation and how it's presented. Albert Einstein was once asked, what makes a great theory? And Einstein said, unless a theory can be explained to a child, the theory is probably useless. Meaning that all great theories are pictorial. There's a picture that energizes a principle behind all great theories of physics. So why are certain things harder than other things? Because they're not presented correctly. The essence of something is usually a picture. Newtonian mechanics, which rules our world, is based on planets, stars going around each other in orbits, a very simple picture. Relativity is governed by clocks, meter sticks, and string theory, which we think is the theory of everything, is based on little violin strings. So I think everything can be presented well if it's presented pictorially to illustrate a principle. Okay, next question.
There's a lot of promise and potential for all this work, but also think about the possibility of hacking and so forth. You can't even shop a target without getting some of your data lifted. What happens when they're putting computer chips, and a lot of us, for the malfeasance issue that comes up?
I didn't understand. Could you repeat the question again? How? I...
Well, that when you're making a really direct connection between your brain and digital technology, that there's a great opportunity for hackers and for difficult things to happen, problematic things to happen. You can't even do a financial transaction without necessarily risking information being lost to people who might use it, misuse it. How would that be when you're, there's a chip inside your brain or you're connected to the internet, so to speak?
I didn't quite hear. What you're saying is how can it be misused? Is that what you're
saying?
Well,
what's the potential for it being misused?
Okay. There is a vast potential for this technology to be misused if you can upload incorrect memories. If false memories can be encoded, then you have to make sure that the subject understands the difference between reality and unreality. It's one thing to upload a vacation. And in the movie Total Recall, they uploaded a memory of a marriage. So it's one thing to think your marriage is a fake memory. It's another thing if a financial transaction or a crime is uploaded. Our criminal justice system is based on eyewitness accounts. What happens if you can upload false memories? Then eyewitness testimonies don't mean anything anymore. When you say you tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, you think you are telling the truth, when you are actually accessing an incorrect memory that was uploaded into your mind. And so I think, first of all, the benefits of this could be enormous. Workers could retrain if they're laid off on the unemployment line, retrain to learn new skills. If you flunked a course at Berkeley, here's your chance to relearn it again by having the memory uploaded. But if a criminal gets a hold of this, they can begin to upload incorrect memories and start to confuse people. So personally, I think this has to be regulated. You have to have regulation of this so that false memories are not put into your mind without your permission. Okay, next.
In reference to your other answer about pictorial representations, do you think we're close to having a pictorial representation of consciousness anytime soon?
Well, personally, I think that consciousness is something that we all do continually to make a model of where we are in space, time. And you can disprove my theory if you can find a thought that is outside my definition of consciousness. For example, humor. You may say to yourself, ha, telling a joke is so ephemeral that it does not fit this classification. But you see, it does. Because when you hear a joke, before you hit the punchline, you complete the future. You complete the ending. And then when the ending is different from what you anticipated, it becomes funny. So let me tell you something. W.C. Fields was once asked about the education of youth. And he was asked, are you in favor of clubs for youth? And then he said, yes, but only if kindness fails. And then Teddy Roosevelt's daughter, was asked about gossip. And she said, if you have nothing good to say about somebody, then please come sit next to me. And what if the Bible says, do unto others as you would have them do unto you, except do it first. These are, quote, funny. Because when you hear that clubs are good for youth, you say to yourself, I'm going to complete that thought. Yes, clubs are good because it keeps young kids off the street out of trouble. But then when you hear that only if kindness fails, you begin to realize there's a twist in your prediction of the future. We are prediction machines. Humor is when the prediction is disrupted. And when your mother told you, if you have nothing good to tell other people, you were told, then say nothing at all. But the twist is, please come sit next to me.